God continue to be her caregiver.
Yes, in the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus.
I know too much is given, much is required.
Yes.
But there are things that can make you feel overwhelmed.
Yes.
Oh my God.
And thank God for the great caregiver.
Yes. Yes.
Who would care for those who don't have a lot of people caring for them, but yet the work is still there, right?
Yes.
Right?
Oh, yes.
And that beautiful daughter who is giving all she has right now. We just touch and agree for her strength and for her care. You see? You got everybody turn me to Psalms, the 86th chapter. I said it before and I'll say it again. Sometimes you don't know how good today is until tomorrow.
Come on now.
All kinds of things can happen tomorrow.
Yes.
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 You see?
Yes.
And sometimes tomorrow tell you how good today was.
Yes.
Yes.
And you sit and think, wow, yesterday was a good day.
Yes.
As compared to today, you
yes.
see?
Yes.
But you don't know it sometime until tomorrow.
Right. Amen.
That's the lesson in it.
Yes.
You see?
Yes.
But tomorrow, you know, not knowing what a day will bring, we see the right now, even we who are apostolic prophetic, well, God look at the not yet. It's so important to be connected to the great caregiver.
Yes.
You see? We bless you, Lord, for our own minister, Marcus, and his lovely wife, who are back with us today. After dealing with what they dealt with. Whatever it was, you know. They're healthy and they're here. And we thank God for that. And we love them and miss them. You see. And so they say it's praying time, right?
Yes.
Look at the ones too. You say it's always been praying time. When you say it's praying time, it can suggest that there are times that it's not praying time. But it's always praying time. You see?
Yes.
You pray not with enticing words of man's wisdom. But out of your heart, or whatever it is you do, you see?
Yes.
Like those ministers today. And believe me, it's good to have help. Each one prayed something that I would not have prayed. So you'll know. You understand? I know my prayer. But to have people connected to certain things, praying what they pray. You understand? It helps to have help.
Yes.
You see?
Thank you, God. Thank you, God. Thank you, God. Lord, my Savior. King Jesus.
Because I spend time praying for the baby's face to be clean.
Yes, God.
Hair combed.
Well, my God. Yes, Lord.
Underwear on.
Yes, my Savior.
All the things I've dealt with.
My Savior.
She don't have no underwear at first lady.
Yes, my Savior, God. My Savior, God.
He's on the bus and he leave home every day hungry.
Lord,
so we've been doing this a long time.
Yes, God.
So we pray what we pray.
Yes.
You see?
Yes.
We've had a lot of the night of domestic violence.
Yes,
and
my God.
I've had the phone call, I need your help. She's saying her dad touching her.
Lord, yes, Jesus, my Savior, God.
And so let's call dad.
My you God, see? Yes, Savior.
I've had the 8th grader at the door when I missed the bus. Well, I tell you what, I'm not taking you without your face washed and your hair combed and your teeth brushed.
Yes.
So by the time you do that, I'll be pulling up. Go right back home and do that. He had my back door, you know.
Yes.
And so when you have that, you pray out of what you pray out of. You see?
Yes.
You understand?
Yes.
You understand, right?
Yes.
And so I thank God for help today. If you have anybody, turn to me Psalms, the 86 chapters.
Lord, my Savior Jesus, my Savior.
You see, right?
My Savior.
And then you have people all over the world, like Minister Tia, who is taking care of so many people.
Yes, so many.
You understand?
Yes,
yes. And you have to love the Lord to do it in the spirit of love.
Yes.
You know, you have a caregiver tonight who is snatching covers.
Yeah.
You know, being aggressive.
Yes.
Slapping and spanking. Hitting, so you know, not kids, hitting grown-ups, whooping grown-ups, you know, I'm serious, you understand, and hating what she or he have to do. You have to love God to do things in the spirit of love. Now, the task itself proves that you're in the right place, so you know. Because what God gives you to do, He gives you the grace to do it.
Amen.
When there is no grace to do it, you question if this is your calling.
Yes.
You see?
Yes.
So you don't know.
You teach it.
Whatever He calls you to, He gives you the grace to do it.
Yes.
When you can answer that, I have grace for this, then I say, okay, then do it. When you cannot answer that, I say, well, be careful with this. You know, I'm not telling you what to do, but you know, you don't have grace for it. Now, it can be something that you think is small. But when you factor in 168 hours, which is a week, and you know, 24 hours, and you factor in 30 days,
yes,
and then 365, even though it looked at the beginning like a small thing, it's not a small thing. When you start factoring in time spent doing it, or with, you know, now all of a sudden, you know, it shows whether you have the grace for it.
Right.
You see?
Yes.
You see?
Yes.
You have to have the grace for it.
Help us, Jesus.
You understand, right?
Help us, that your will be done, God. Help us, help us, help us, Lord.
That's why I always apologize when I do homegoings or funerals for tomorrow. Because I know tomorrow, the family's still in their grief.
Yeah.
And some never leave.
Yes.
It's forever like living with an amputation.
Yeah.
And they don't leave.
Yes.
It gets better, but it don't leave. You come out sometime like me, like you're out, but you're scarred.
Yes.
You know, you're never the same.
Yes.
And, you know, and so tomorrow, while I'm cutting my grass and you at Walmart or someone else at Walgreens,
yeah,
or someone else go to the movie theater, you know, the family's still in their grief.
Yes, they are.
That buried mama yesterday.
Right.
You know, that put Danny in the ground yesterday.
Yes.
That said goodbye to my daughter. But, you know, they still in it. And so I always apologize for tomorrow. You know, and let them know how much they need God more tomorrow than today. Because today you have a host of people, you know, trying to love on you. Tomorrow you left with just the realization of the finalization, you know. They say, like, look for closure, but some things there is no closure. They say it is, but that door for some things stay open. What you try to do is you try to learn how to either deal with it or you spend a lifetime trying to avoid it. Turning from pictures and doing this and moving from this, and I don't want to talk about that. You know, I hope you get a lot of energy going into that.
Yeah.
You know, and I don't knock is that some people's strategy of how they deal with it.
Yeah.
They get rid of everything, all the pictures, all the memories, and they just can't do that.
Wow.
Well, other people, they have it all around like a shrine. You know, everyone is different.
Yeah, everyone is different.
You know, and if you're by yourself, it's easy to handle that. When you live with people, each one have a right to how they want to handle a situation.
Right.
So I have to have grace to go into like First Lady's area because it's not like my, like I do my prayer room in my area.
Yes.
So I don't even go in there much, you know.
Yes.
It's not what I do.
Yeah.
You understand?
Mm-hmm.
You understand, right?
Yes.
Psalms 87, the one is to be said, you see.
Yes.
Because when he say in by scripture that you must be born again to see the kingdom.
That's right.
Like you must be born again.
That's right.
To see. That word see there is to comprehend, to understand.
Yes, yes.
Not like this see, you know,
right,
like, to understand.
Yes, right.
You know, you can't even see it, you can't even enter. When you can't see it, you can't enter.
Yes, right.
You must be born again. What do I climb into my mother's womb a second time to be born?
No.
That is flesh is flesh.
Right.
That is spirit is spirit.
Right.
you must be born again to see the kingdom.
Yeah.
And so I spent a lifetime ministry. People normally saying, you see, you see, you see.
Yeah.
Which means you understand.
Yeah.
You see, you get it.
Yeah.
But it's not until I dive into my word that I understand what I really have been asking these many years. And I said, you see, don't you see? You see, right? Don't you see? Or do you understand? Do you get it? Now, everyone don't hear the same thing even now. They don't see the same thing even now. You see? And so the Lord told me everyone must eat. So that means he must strategize a service where everyone eats. Just like at you know, at a restaurant.
Right. Wonderful.
Everyone must eat.
Thank
you see?
Yes.
And so they must be at everyone's level.
Yes. Thank God for Jesus.
You understand?
Yes, yes.
You see?
Yes.
And then when we start dealing by way of social media and things of this nature, there's times you have to leave the room. Like, is that in the room? Well, maybe on social media.
Yeah. Right. You have your way, God.
That's a whole different kind of,
you know.
You understand? And you're not intimidated by when you in the heart of God. Remember, the only thing you need to be used by God is his heart.
Yes, yes.
Amen.
You understand?
Yes. Amen.
Amen.
So when my daughter watched the TV, I said, look, like reality TV. Now, that's the correction. You see that? Now, you see her? She smells style. Can you smell her, daughter? But she's still like, I don't want to smell. Her face is like, I don't want to smell her. But I want you to know that God will let you smell her from this living room.
Wow.
He will let you feel that witchcraft from right here.
Yes.
You understand? He will let you learn in this front room. You let me help you. So now I'm telling you, she smelled like this, and I tell her. He thinks like this.
Mm-hmm.
You understand?
Yeah.
Sometimes God proves to her while we're watching it as the program
goes
on.
Yeah, yeah. Oh my God.
You understand?
Yeah. Thank you, God.
I said that to say you have to be in that place to know what's in the room and what's on social media.
Yes.
He says in Psalms 86, and then we're flying. Bow down thine ear.
Mm-hmm.
O Lord, hear me, for I am poor and needy. Preserve my soul, for I am holy. O thou, my God, save thy servant that trusteth in thee. Be merciful unto me. Be merciful unto me. O Lord, for I cry unto thee what? Daily. Rejoice the soul of thy servant, for unto thee, O Lord, do I lift up my soul. For thou, Lord, art good and ready to forgive, and plenteous in mercy unto all them that, very important, call upon thee. That's very important. That's very important, okay? So I don't want you to miss that. Bow down thy ear. You sit high, I look low. Press your ear close to my lips. It's so far.
Yes.
We are so far. But he know how to close the gap. And even when I'm not my strongest, he know how to hear a whisper. Now he's such a discerner of the heart. He know how to listen to a heart that has no words coming out of his mouth. You understand? You said it was in vain to serve the Lord. Lord, when did we say such things? You said it in your heart,
yes.
Right?
Yes.
And so we look at the outer appearance, not look at the heart. So he's able to bow down an ear, press it close to a lip and or a heart, and a sound that cannot be heard. Now there's a silence that is definitely, it's just so loud.
Yes.
It'll run you crazy.
Yes.
I said a silence.
He
know how to do it. And he says, and he looks here and says, and plenteous in mercy unto all of them that call upon thee. Give ear, O Lord, unto my prayer, and attend to the voice of my supplication. In the day of my trouble, I will call upon thee, but thou wilt answer me.
Yes.
Very unusual.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord.
The New Living Translation, Psalms 86 and 1. Bend down, O Lord, and hear my prayer. Answer me, for I need your help.
Yes, yes.
Now that's so unusual that he says, for I need your help. It's unusual in the fact that he's speaking like this in a time where there really may not be trouble. You know that because he says, in the day of trouble, I will call on thee. So he's praised as if I need to be prayed up. If I can talk to you like that. He wanted to be prayed up. You see? So he prays almost like I'm before things. I like to be before things, which we do. I like to get in the right. I'm in the right now, you're in the not yet. And I feel like I need to pray like this. I need to get in the not yet. It's not yet as far as my time, but it may be yet now as far as spirit. Remember, some things are not about if God is going to do them, they're done. It's about manifestation. It's about manifestation. It's not about if. You don't know. It's already done. It's about when will it be manifested. And that's why I have to follow on to know. He says in verse, protect me, verse 2, for I am devoted to you. Now understand, this is pleading and begging that relationship. This is pleading and begging by relationship.
My God. Thank you,
Lord. He says, save me, for I serve you and trust you. You are my God. Be merciful to me, O Lord, for I am calling on you constantly. Give me happiness, O Lord, for I give myself to you. I love that. O Lord, you are so good, so ready to forgive, so full of unfailing love for all who ask for help. Listen closely to my prayer. Oh Lord, hear my urgent cry. I will call to you whenever I'm in trouble, and you will answer me. Look at what you say, friend. If you're a woman, God is with. Stand together for Jesus. Yeah. Now the soul don't just ascend by itself. This is what we call an ascending soul. But it's not just ascending by itself. You ascend on the wings of faith and holy desire. There's a fervency to this. There's an urgency and a zeal to this. Remember, zeal is not bad. Now, we know some have had a zeal, not according to knowledge. But you must at some point be zealous, have a zeal. Or you want to call it a fire. The same fire that burned out everything not like God. It's the same fire that stirs up the gift. Not a different fire. The same fire that eradicates sin is the same fire that get you moving, set your soul on fire. You need a fire. I need a fire. Imagine going through this walk trying to do what God called you to do with no zeal and no fire. No, you need a fire. A Holy Ghost fire. He petitions God. He says, be gracious and hear me. Be gracious and hear me. I shall be gracious to whom I choose to be gracious, said the Lord. Yes. He's saying, look, make sure you choose me. Look, say, Lord, make sure you choose me. He's asking. He's not taking it for granted that I'm entitled to this. That I'm entitled for you to be gracious to me. He says, no, I'm asking you, be gracious and hear me. Preserve me. All them who God will save, he also preserves, which he maintains. He said, I'm in you, but I need you to maintain me in you. I'm saved, but I need you to keep me saved. Remember, we're still talking about the great shepherd, the good shepherd. He says, I'm a sheep, but I need you to shepherd me. I'm not trying to live this life on my own and by myself. I'm not trying to work it all out by myself. I'm not trying to keep myself saved. I'm not trying to pass every spiritual test. I'm not trying to do that. I'm not trying to contend with a devil by myself. I'm not trying to contend with the prince of the air and the god of the world by myself. That's not what I'm trying to do. I'm not trying to say, I got lust and I got perverted attention. And I'm going to make sure that I don't fornicate with my girlfriend. And I'm going to make sure I don't cheat on my wife. And I'm going to make sure. I'm not trying to do that. I'm not trying to do that. No, I'm not trying to act like I'm standing, lest I fall. I'm not trying to do that. I'm not trying to play God. I'm not trying to keep my own sanity. You know, like, I got my own sanity. I got my own, I'm gonna make sure I don't go crazy. I'm not trying to do that. And I'm not trying to do that. But listen, God has said, you have me, so you maintain me. You preserve me. If you have me, preserve me. Keep me. When men show no mercy, be not as a man, is what he's saying. When he says, Lord, have mercy, what he's saying is men show no mercy. But you, Lord, be not like a man. Now, anytime a person asks for mercy, they're asking God to keep them for what they think they deserve. When you ask for grace, you say, Lord, do for me what I can't do for myself. When you ask for mercy, you say, Lord, keep me from what I deserve. When you ask for grace, you say, Lord, give me what I don't deserve. For by grace are you saved through Christ Jesus. Give me what I don't deserve. But when I say mercy, I know why I'm saying mercy. If I don't, my spirit do. Because my spirit is saying to God, keep me from what I deserve. Now you have a boatload of people who don't think they need mercy because they don't understand from the beginning things are one way, but in iniquity and sin where you conceive.
Yes, yes.
Any man, any woman born in iniquity and sin need mercy.
Yes.
Even if you say, I've never did a thing wrong in my life, you were born after the fall of man. David said, Lord, in iniquity and sin was I conceived.
Yeah.
I already know I got some problems. If they not manifest, they will be.
Right, right, right.
It's like those folk that, you know, test for COVID but they have no symptoms, who pre-symptomatic, and
right.
2 days later, and you know, it's just a matter of time. It's a matter of time. It's just a matter of time. But I felt good here. Y'all know we did. But we still was moonwalking. We still was bagging up because we know it's just a matter of time. He said, you're not a man. They don't give, man don't give mercy.
No.
The man don't give mercy. He don't forget. He holds things over your head. You have to earn everything. You know, like, you got to earn it. I know I don't have any more sick time, but my spouse is sick and I need to be off. But I need to get paid.
Oh, wow.
Mm.
No, you don't have that
town here. You know you're not in church, right? You know you're at the University of Chicago Hospital, right?
Right.
He looks and says, don't be a man, be a God. He keeps from inward. He looks and says, look, Lord, keep, when you look at me outwardly and inwardly.
Yes.
And in the inward parts, I'm asking my relationship, make me happy.
Ooh.
Which means, make sure I have spiritual joy.
Right.
Wow.
He's pleading this.
Yeah.
He's in his prayer, not taking anything for granted. Give me what I need. Make me happy.
Yes.
I just want to, you hear people say all the time, I just want to be happy.
Yes.
I just want to be happy. I just want to be happy. And the people who say it are not happy. This is the reason why they're saying it.
Right. Right.
I just want to be happy. You are, now, you. We don't have a bunch of things for you. Well, what we have is these 66 books.
Come on.
I'm not trying to make you think that every time your husband can make you happy or your wife. I'm not trying to make you think even life will hand you something happy. Sometimes the best you're going to do is the joy of the Lord, which is your strength. And you're going to do that for some people, that's unto death. That's how you're going to ride this thing out.
Oh my God. As unto death. As unto death.
He speaks to God as if I'm not taking for granted these things are coming my way. And he does it on the basis that we have a relationship.
Yeah.
Look at the one or two say, man, God have a relationship.
Yeah, God have a relationship.
He don't want anything by grace, by mercy, even though he's asking for it.
Yeah.
He's asking for grace and mercy, but he's asking for it by relationship.
Yeah.
He don't want, look at what you said, you don't want everything by grace and mercy. Some things you want because I love you and you love me. There are some things you want because you really, you earned it.
Right.
Come on,
you got other folk that think, say you can't earn anything. Yes, you can earn something. Time spent with the Lord means something. Walking upright and forth, you know, means something. And I don't need 6 months to 8 months. And you know, I've been selling it 3 months. God owe me something. We need to owe you another test, another trial. He says we have relationship, but thou art my God. I'm devoted to you. I totally depend on you. Thou art my God. What does that sound like to you? Thou art my God. That means that no one, nothing else is my God but you. I have no one on your level. You're not competing against anything. Thou art my God.
Jesus.
He says, make it that way. There's no competition. There's no one who's pulling on me good. Thou art my God. You have no competition. I'm asking everything because, look, you are my God. If I don't talk to you, I don't talk to anyone. If I don't ask you, it can't be done. If you don't do it, it's not done. Thou art my God. For I am poor and needy, which means I need your help. It sounds different if first they say, I want you to do something. That sounds so much different than us, but I need your help. Okay. So you'll know. Yeah. I want you to do something. I may say, oh, well, not right now. Right. If she said, oh, well, husband, I need your help. I said, what is it then? Right. It just provoked right. Something else I need. Yeah. That I love just said, I need your help.
Yeah.
It's different. I want you to do something. You got time to do something? No, I don't. I really don't. That says me most. No, I really don't. But her husband, look, I need your help. Well, what is it?
Yes.
I want now. I want help.
Help.
Help. He used the right terminology.
Yes.
I need your help.
Your right terminology.
You don't help me, I don't have help. I talk to a single mother with children and say, are you single? Yeah, you have children? Yeah. Then act like a single woman with children.
Right.
You have a lot of help? No. Then act like a single woman with children without a lot of help.
Right.
Think. You on your own. You don't have a husband at home making 6 figures and a bunch of help. You got to think.
Yeah, you do.
Amen. He says, I need your help. Do this because I call on you constantly. To keep me from what I deserve, being born in iniquity and sin, I call on you constantly. What does that mean? That means I don't just call on you when it pleases me. I don't just call on you when I need something. I call on you constantly.
Come on, man.
God of my morning, God of my midday, God of my evening, God of my night.
That's it. Come on.
I'm just always in your hands. Lord, I love you. Lord, I bless you. Lord, I thank you. I just need your face. Oh, today, Lord, I need you. Lord, help me. The next day, Lord, I bless you. I'm just always in your face calling on you. I don't treat you like a Santa Claus. I don't treat you like a pimp. I don't treat you like a dope pusher. I don't treat you like I need a fix. This ain't a fix. This is a relationship. You say that constantly. That's what that means. I'm always calling on you constantly. He says, make me happy, make me joyful down on the inside because I give myself away. Now, what does that mean? That means you didn't take me, you didn't force me, I came willingly. You didn't have to put me in the belly of a fish, you didn't have to lock me up in prison, you didn't have to hit me with a sickness. When you called, I came. I want to be here. I give myself away. Now, you're not taking me. You're not talking to me like, why don't you come, son? I'm coming. Look, I'm here. This is what ground I'm basing all my prayer on. This is our relationship. And I give myself away. That's huge. That he's not forcing me into prayer every day. He's not forcing me to constantly call on him. I'm not calling on him constantly because I got a limp and a sickness and something wrong with me. I call on him just to call on him. He says, and I give myself away. I give myself to you willingly, look, and gladly. He said, and we have relationship in so much that I can say, Lord, you are so good, so ready, so willing to forgive with unfailing love, look, but to all who ask for help. That's so key. Because when I say, you can't forgive anyone, you can try, but you can't. And then I have the religious people say, now that's a lie, that ain't true. And then you see all these people who say to people, I forgive you. And then the person will look back, I didn't ask you for forgiveness. I'm not sorry. I forgive you anyway. Then they walk around for years and still something wrong with them because they don't have closure there. Right. Well, you're not getting closure there.
Right.
No, you're not. You're not getting closure there. Jesus is ready and willing to forgive. That's what he said. You're always willing. You're always ready. You're always still ready. Well, why are you just ready? Why don't you just do? Father, forgive them for they know not what they do. Don't mean that instantaneously God forgave them. It means make set up opportunity for them to see their wrong and they repent.
Amen.
It don't mean that God says right now they're forgiven. And they look like, we didn't ask. We don't want to be forgiven. Why would hell enlarge us? Why would she do that? Without measure. Why? Why would she do that? Why would God say, I have a people who are on their way to hell because they have not known me? Like, why would he say that? Why would he say that? Now he said, right there, I'm ready to forgive. Yes. And then you look at the people and say, but all you gotta do is ask for it. Right. But you gotta ask.
Right.
You gotta ask.
Right.
I ain't asking. But I'm ready. Okay. I ain't asking. But I'm right here. I ain't asked you that. See, I found out because some people are tired, don't mean they want salvation.
Wow.
Because some people want change, don't mean they want to be saved.
That's right.
Uh-uh. No, they don't mean that. I thought everyone that was in a certain broken place and fatigued place, they were ready. They said, now you're ready. I ain't say I want to do that. I ain't say I want to be saved. I ain't say I want to be a Christian. Look at you.
Right.
What else you going to be?
Right.
I'm just saying, I'm going through a hard time right now. I ain't saying I can't make a commitment. So you can't make a commitment? You have folks that have the audacity to ask for prayer and don't want to be saved.
Right.
At all.
Okay.
I ask for prayer.
Yeah.
Don't want to be saved. Mm-hmm. He looks and says, we have a ready God who loves us.
Yes.
A loving love. He's not just ready to be ready. But whatever you call him about, he's ready. He's not just ready to be ready. He said he's ready for whatever you call on him about. He is ready. In your mind, he's ready. Your body, he's ready to help you have better money management skills. He's ready. He's ready to help that domestic situation. He's ready. Whatever you need him to be, he is. When they ask who sent you, tell him, I am that I am sent you. I am a healer, I am. I'm a mind regulator. I'm a friend if I need to be. I'm a comforter. I am whatever you need me to be. But what about me hearing voices? I am a mind regulator. Whatever you need me to be, I am. But what about these feelings I have? Don't worry about those feelings. Just give your life to the Lord. Just come to me. To bring the feelings with you. Don't try to act like you don't have them. You have them, bring them with you.
I'm teaching now.
You just need to be born again, born from above. When you see all these proclivities and habits and all of this weakness within the body of Christ, it's a sign that folk not born again. They don't want to admit it. They don't want to admit it. Because it sounds like they're saying, you're saying, what I'm telling you is you're a Christian, but you're not a born again believer. Because born again believers, that stuff we came down here with, God took it away. He snatched it out of us. Now, they don't want to talk like this because many of them stand out of the pulpit with those same proclivities and habits.
Yes, they do.
That's why they condone what they condone.
There you go.
Yes.
Well, you got to tell
them. That's why they can condone what they're condoning. Have you ever seen a 600-pound pastor stand up and say, God, I'll get that weight off of you and God, I'll make you healthy? You ain't never seen it. He's not going to say that. She's not going to say that. Because she's not going to spend that 600 pounds to be able to say that.
Right.
You say, what are you saying? I'm saying when you got lust in your life and cheating in your life, perverted tendencies and mental health issues, you ain't going to stand there and say, God, I can deal with those mental health issues.
Yeah. Right.
You're not going to do it.
Right. Come on.
You can't do it. You can't do it.
I can't do it. So sad.
Whatever you need me to be, I am. Born again believers, God says you are born not from above.
Yes.
It doesn't matter to me the proclivities your daddy passed on and your mom passed on and your great auntie passed on. You're not born of that bloodline anymore. Now you're born from above. And I am the Lord. I change not. If I change not, then you change not. Once you're born again, you should be born again. I said that and I said again, there is no prophet from before the foundation of the world who get here, go out of a sex change, and come back and sit down and prophetess. It don't work that way. Before the foundation, before you was in your mother's womb, I knew you. Before you came forth out of her womb, I knew you. And sanctified you a prophet. Jeremiah, you a prophet. And before the foundation of the world, you a prophet. Well, I feel like I'm a man in a woman's body. So he go get the sex change and say, now I'm prophetess Jeremiah. It don't work like that. It would never be. God would never take a prophet and make him a prophetess.
Never.
He would never take a prophetess and make it a prophet.
Never.
It just won't ever happen.
Never.
Whatever you are, you were before the foundation of the world. Your job is to find out now who is that? Everyone is as unique as their fingerprint and their interest.
Yeah.
What makes you you? Look, what makes me me?
What makes me?
My spiritual father said, take the Lord out of my back. My pastor stood up and said, I devil struggle. But what do I do?
Yeah.
I don't come doing that and take the Lord out of my back. I don't do that.
It's
not what I do. What makes me unique? What makes me, what did God say? This is what you do. And I change not. And when you're born again,
yes,
you're born from above.
Yes.
You're born from above.
Yes.
From above.
Yes.
People don't want to talk about being born again because now they have to admit that the proclivities and habits and things that I were doing, I can't do anymore because that was before my born again experience.
Yes.
Everything the Christian. Everything. You can beat the drums and ain't praying in 2 months. You can dance and ain't prayed in 3 months. You can preach and ain't prayed in 6 months.
Never.
Yeah.
Anything, everything a Christian. You can come in a church and halfway take it over. You can sow seeds of discord all over the place because leadership ain't praying, ain't fasting, all he is a Christian.
My God, Jesus.
Christ said you must be born again. He never once said you must be a Christian. Not one time.
Wow. Wow.
Not one time did he look and say, you must be a Christian. But he did say, you must be born again. Can I come in my mama's womb second time to come out? No. That, if you go in your mama's womb 1,000 times, you coming out 1,000 times flesh. That was his flesh is flesh, but that was his spirit is spirit. All the way in the Old Testament, David had that understanding with all this revelation. That you are spirit, you are God.
Yes, God. Yes, God.
You're not a man, you're not flesh.
Yes,
he told him all the way in the Old Testament, I'm not a man that I should like, or a son of a man, I need to repent. I am not you. Since you're not me, I'm not gonna treat you like you need. Maintain me. Keep me.
Yes.
Lord, you are so good and so ready, so willing. All you have to do is ask. I give you an urgent cry because I'm always praying. So when trouble do come, My answers are already there. Look, I got the prayer wheel turning. I don't have to get them turning because of trouble. They're already turning. I'm already in motion. I don't have to find you. This is so unusual that he would pray like he in trouble and then say, because when trouble come.
Amen.
Man, I thought the whole time you were in trouble. You praying like someone in trouble. I'm in the chapel praying, and I'm crying out before the Lord on my lunch break, and a saved Caucasian lady, a nurse or someone I never met her before, I didn't see her, you come in, and I felt a hand on my shoulder. So, look, what the? Man of God. You look like you're in so much pain. Can I pray for you?
Wow.
I said, thank you, sis. I really appreciate it. I had tears, man. I said, I'm just crying out before the Lord. I just need to cry out. Are you sure? Because like, I see them like, is that crying out? What is this? Well, I come from castration and hanging on a tree. I come from food stamps and wick and cheese lines. I come from, you know, ducking and dodging and trying to make it through the park. I come from a one-time STD called gonorrhea. That's not even serving advice for. I come from a daddy who was domestically violent and mistreated me. I came from not feeling safe. So I'm not going to look like you. I don't have those kind of entitlement things. I don't pray like you. So I may look like I'm in a lot of pain.
Maybe I am.
She said, are you sure? Because you look like you're so I don't know what I was looking like. I was stretched out in my hour of prayer. It's the chapel. I'm not being loud. I'm not saying one word. I'm not like, no. I know who I am. This orderly guy. I'm in the chapel in the hospital.
Come on now.
I don't know what was.
Pastor
in the hospital. God. At least you got that part right. It's turning. It was turning. It's turning for him, and he got it turning. And still, something going on that it should be turning. Why are you running? No one is chasing you. It's what I do. Why are you crying? And no one, if you're not sad, it's what I do. It's just what I do. It's just what I do. It's just what you preaching. You gotta be studying like you preach. It's what I do. It's just what I do.
You're my king.
Just what I do. He said that I have the prayer wheel turning all the time. I don't have to get it geared up, reared up. I don't have to. Some things I avoid, I never even get into because of the prayer wheel. There's some experiences I never have. Why? Because of the prayer wheel. If I stop praying, I'm going to have experiences that you have. But if I keep praying, I ride past the experiences you have. See, I hear it in the spirit. There's a hearing, then there's a hearing. So the Lord tell me don't touch it, it's hot. In prayer, I don't touch it, it's hot. But you have to touch it and see that it's hot. So now you have the experience of being burned. Now I had it by just hearing God say don't touch it, it's hot. But I had it in the prayer wheel.
Yes, God.
Now me and you going to end up in the same place. I'm going to end up there without burns and scars. You're going to end up there looking like you've been burned to death.
Wow. Yes.
Because you're one of those people who don't hear so well. You won't have the prayer wheel turning. You're not in the most holy thing. He loves you. I gave you a call on him.
So good. Yes, God.
But I've been asking God, calling on God. Why won't he hear me? Why won't God minister to me? I've been calling on the Lord. Are you sure God not ministering to you?
Right.
Are you sure that a shepherd don't care about a sheep? I don't get that. I don't get that a shepherd, a loving shepherd, don't care about a sheep crying out. I don't get that. Everything is for purpose when your steps are ordered of the Lord. Do God want you to go through something? Do you need to learn what you need to learn so you can come out of that? Like, what is it? Every time you get here, do you do something you shouldn't do? Are you like 8 months, 9 months? Yes, paying my mortgage on time. 10 months? Yes. then 11-month holidays, and I had 2 30-day days in November, December. Like, I don't know what it is. I know that God cares about the sheep. If you don't know how to get out, you hook on to someone else that know how to get out. There's two sets of sheep in here. One know God's voice, the other one don't, but he know the person who do. Hook on to the person who do. Listen to everything they saying and be obedient. Stop talking back, Peter, and stop doubting everything, Thomas, and come on out.
Yes, real good.
Come out. You come out. You have a God standing ready to give. Well, if you confess your faults, he's willing to forgive you your sin and cleanse you from all unrighteousness. You have folk that have heard so many messages and been in church so long that they don't even know how to hear anymore. Not a rain word.
Come on now. Come on.
You have to hear God and move. The king's business requires haste. And look at the one that's teaching saying, you his business. You require haste. He moves for you. If nothing else, he set a hedge of protection around you. Even if you say, I don't know what God is talking to me. Do you think this God is unfair? You will walk up and tell the devil, I close your mouth. I don't want you speaking to my child anymore in this season while they learn my voice. I put a hedge around their ears and a guard around their ears, and even if you speak, they can't get through it. You can't get in like you couldn't get in Job unless I let you. He makes this fight fair. Then he shut the devil's mouth, or he opens and protects your ear gates that nothing can penetrate but him. But him, as he teaches you his voice. Now, as he teaches you his voice, you stop making all those weird decisions and all those weird errors and giving all those off prophecies and having all those weird dreams, and because now the only one who wants to talk to you is God. Now you have to get it when you're supposed to get it, because at some point he's going to open the door so you can experience both he and the devil. So he can let you see. Now see how it feels. See how I felt for the last 6 months. Now see how I feel now that he's speaking again and I'm talking. See the difference, how I line up with the word letter by letter, like I by I, T by T. See how we do this?
Yeah.
You get it?
Yeah.
He lets you feel the difference.
Yes.
He lets you feel the difference. Yes. He let lust come and work and put the hand on the shoulder to talk to you, and you don't even feel it. Then he says, I shall not expose you to lust. And the same person come and touch you, and all of a sudden now, you feel it. And he asks you questions. See the difference between my hand and lust? See the difference between witchcraft and me? You know, he teach you this.
Yes, he does.
Thank you, God.
But I guess you have people who not in what we call deliverance. Salvation is deliverance. Deliverance is salvation. You don't live your life like you walked in the door for the first day. You don't speak failure all the time. And woe is me, and I'm so this, and woe is me. But if somebody looks at you and says, you better shake yourself and let's go.
Yeah.
Teach.
Yeah, you better say it.
That's right.
We're not doing this today, are we?
Right.
Every time I see you, we're doing this? Now, come on, now, I can't do this today.
Right.
Everything, right? Everything?
Yeah.
All inclusive?
Right.
Everything is.
Everything. Everything's a thing. Everything.
You need to push that thing back so you can see everything is not, you know.
Yes, yes.
He looks and he builds this whole prayer on relationship.
Yeah.
It's all about relationship. How much I love you. How good you have been to me. It's all about relationship. And when I get into a certain place, I don't have any reservation. You're going to be there for me. It's not like you don't know me. You still hear me every single day.
That's right.
Every day. Now, if you want to pray for me, go ahead. But believe me when I tell you, I'm not going to let you pray for me by yourself. Before we pray, that's what the Father called, told me, Al, all next week, we are fasting for this particular person.
Okay.
And y'all want you up every day at 4 or 5 o'clock.
Yeah.
4 to 5 or 5,
yeah.
4 to 5, something like that.
Yeah.
Boom, I pop up, bam, ready to pray, fast and pray. Next day, I pop up, pray, bam, bam. Next day, he called me, hey, go to sleep.
Right.
Go to sleep, sometime, go to sleep. Okay. I called the person
yeah.
that we fasting and praying for.
Right.
He said, somebody was sleep.
They were sleep.
Sleep. He said, now, if they are going to go to sleep,
Right.
It requires it.
Amen.
Which I told the person. He said, so now I release you from this.
Right.
Because
yes.
I'm going to see. He said, that's all. You go to sleep. We're not doing this.
We're not doing this.
We're not doing this. If they cared, they would have been woke.
Yes.
If they really wanted it, they would have been crying out. We crying out for them.
That's true. That's true.
If they really wanted it, they listen to the counsel. If you really want it, you something in you a gift. It's like the babies going back to school. You're setting precedent for them that of how this year is going to be. I want you to know day one, I want the honor roll.
Yeah.
I want you to know day one, I want perfect attendance.
Right.
Come on.
I want you to know day one, I want any problems.
Yeah.
I mean day one. The minute I don't treat day one with respect, I set precedent for how the year going to be.
Yeah.
The minute I don't treat it right, I set the movement of not of the same. The minute I don't treat it right, the minute I don't have some kind of structure for you, the kids, they don't need parents, they need guardians. They need folks standing over them, looking at them. Now cut that off, now cut that on, now let them get you can tell them, and you can tell them, hey, man, that, hey, what is your own? Give them that. They need courses and guardianship.
Yes, they do. Yes, they do.
The minute you don't set the momentum right, you have set the stage for your own frustration and you don't know it. Because you had a chance of starting day one right.
Amen.
Day one. Day one. I want a whole year of perfect attendance. But what if I get sick? You're not going to get sick.
Right.
I asked Jesus for a whole year of perfect attendance. But what if I don't get sick? You're not going to feel good every morning. You're going to feel good every single morning. You're going to feel good. What if I'm late? You're not going to be late. I'm going to make sure you're not late in Jesus' name. I want a whole year. Perfect attendance is no problem.
Amen.
I'm on the road.
Come on.
Look, when you get home today, I don't care if they didn't give you homework. You study something.
Come on. Yes.
Yeah.
Come on.
Yes, God.
We're going to set this momentum right here, right now.
Say it, Pastor.
The minute I feel like that,
yes.
I open a door that I may can't close.
Yes.
And everything that has been predicated on perfect attendance,
yes.
The whole thing that has been predicated on that,
yes.
The minute I let you see this is not that important. There's some people, they take advantage of advantages.
Yes,
we only the Bible said, give no advantages.
No advantage.
Come on, let's rest on our feet. Give no advantages.
No.
He said, if you call, he went out. If you call, he's standing ready. If you call, sometimes he don't always do what you want him to do. You know, people say sometimes he don't do it when you want it, but he right on time. Well, let me tell you something. Sometimes he not going to do what you ask him to do. It's not in his will. This is why he teach the church how to endure unto devils. That's another conversation. Because if God was going to do everything we asked him to do, that's not a Christian that would die sick that we pray, Lord, heal.
Yes. Yes.
All through every disciple dead. So you know. Anyone has died. Any prophet in the Bible is dead. Something took them out of here. Everyone. It's something we all will deal with that is unto death.
Right.
So this life can be one of those lives where you get everything you want. Sometimes he train you for unto death by not giving you what you want.
Yeah.
He prove if you love him or not. See, you're going to be fine unto death because you don't complain when you don't get your way. You love me just the same.
Yes.
I did want you to, you know, but I love you, Lord. You know, I really thought I needed that, but you must have another way. Because I really needed that. I really needed that. I did. You see? When my son passed, I had to spend time thanking God for loaning him to me so I can get my mind right and my spiritual mind right. that he was long to me, how much I hurt because of how much we could have done. But I thank him because of the time he longed to me. When you love the Lord, you see the love and when you see what he all about. You see him. A man asked me, how was your faith? I said, how was my faith? I never had my faith in my own custody. I always had God maintain me. I never had my faith. Well, lift those hands before Jesus. Lift those hands before Jesus. How was my faith? How was your faith? How was my faith? How was it before this? You don't want to be a public success and a private failure. You want to be someone that have a relationship with the Lord that's personal. You want a testimony where you can say, he is so good. God is so good. I know for myself. You cannot reach in your own soul and pull out what you need until you know him. If you don't accept another second of less than what God has for you, not another second. Not another second. Not another second. You remind yourself that I pray, I call on God. He's all I have. So let me get my mind right. God is all that I have. Let me get my mind right. Some things, if he don't do it, it can't be done. Let me get my mind right. He is the anointing. He don't have to have the anointing. He is the anointing. I have a measure of faithfulness and a measure of anointing. He is the anointing. He asked, is there anything too hard for me? Why think of the thing incredible that I can raise one from the dead? He told us last week that there is a people who can be made whole. And you didn't hear a lot of it. Amen, hallelujah, because so many don't think that they can be made whole.
Exactly.
He said last week, I have a people I can make whole. And I said, hold on. He said, complete, lacking nothing. Lacking nothing. What, 20 or 80? LDL and HDL? No stress? No hearing voices? No schizophrenic? No bipolar? No manic depression? No high highs and low lows? No triggers and traumas and post-traumatic stress. None. Bills paid. I like whole. Happy. Joyful. Whole. Not begging and borrowing. Not dodging and bill collectors. Not popping a bunch of bills. Whole. Not living. Not obese. Just hold, who's willing to come back and glorify you with a loud voice. Just hold. going back. I'm going back to say thank you. Where you going back to say thank you? Thank you so much, God. Thank you so much, Lord. Thank you so much. Were there not 10? All of you all are here. Where now? Where's the 9? All the way there, but here I am. Thank you, Lord. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Because you came and glorified my Father. Amen. I only care about my heart. And you came and glorified my heart. So whatever you need. This ungrateful generation, and this entitled generation, and you dare to come back and say thank you. Whatever you need, what else you need? Well, lift those hands and let's give ourselves away and get out of here. Let's put our hand in. Make it personal, because when I give myself away, you take me into these places. Where my intercessory prayer is even stronger, and my intercessory prayer is even more accurate. When you take me out of myself, when I give myself away. When I give myself away. When I give myself away. We have people been in church double-digit years and still know how to give this stuff away. They still know what they smell like, whatever perfume. They still know what cologne they're wearing. They still know what they want to eat when they leave. Like, they don't know that when you give yourself away, you forget that you have a degree. You forget you have a job. You forget you have a degree. Look, I gave myself away. I didn't give myself away a wife and a husband. I gave myself away a servant and a daughter of the Most High. Look, I forget about, I don't even know who I am. Yes. Yes. Can you please give myself away?
Maker of heaven, and I give it all to you, and I give it all.
what is it? You give him rape. You give him molestation. You give him mistakes.
Cause I'm holding on to you.
You give him that trauma.
It's nothing.
That bad report.
There's nothing.
Those disappointing eyes. How you failed your family. You did them all of that. Let's give it all to him. There's nothing. Overwhelming. When I keep everything to myself, it becomes overwhelming. And then my back hurts, my head, I'm edgy. Kids how to worship. We need fathers that teach their sons how to cry in the Holy Ghost. We need mothers that teach their daughters how to walk the floor. To this cord and back, and just keep doing it. Just keep doing it. Because the sound just walk across this to that cord and back. Stop, daughter, stop. Now, start together. Go. I'm gonna show you how this works.
This is how this works.
Come walk with mama. What we doing? We just talking to Jesus. We just walking in the Holy Ghost. We just, what do I say? Just walk with mama. When mama bless Jesus, you bless Jesus. And when mama thank you, Jesus, you thank you, Jesus. And when mama your will, you go with. When mama pray for her husband, you pray for your dad. And this is how we learn how to do it. This is how we do it. If I grab my belly, you should be grabbing yours. My hand up yours should be up. I say, right there, shake it up or go rock my soul. Then you say whatever come out of your belly. That's how you do it. And if I say, no more devil, then you scratch. No more devil. If I say, God gonna do it, you say, God gonna do it. If I say, no, God's gonna do it, you say it like I said, God's gonna do it.
Yeah.
And that's how you do it. And God won't get me pregnant right here, but I'll get you pregnant. We both need it with purpose.
You're
real then.
Crown I'm
standing on. Children.
With me, yeah.
This the inheritance. This is the inheritance. This is it. This is my strength. These are all family members. But this is how you do it. And mama sitting in here in the watch to see that what's going on. Let me see. Oh my Jesus. Oh my Jesus. Oh my Jesus. Lift those hands, Father, in Jesus' name. When we leave this place, Lord, let it rain. The next time I meet you in prayer, let it rain. Because I've seen darkness shatter in my life.
I've seen joy rain after the night.
The next time I sit with you in the tub, let it rain. Because rep me to God was my father's told me now. Amazing. Let them see it again. For my king, your daughter cried over millions of people and said, they don't know what you can do. They haven't seen what you can do. They don't know how great you are. They don't know what you can do. Because they haven't seen it. Let them see what you can do. In their own personal lives, let them see what you can do. I've seen you take all the medication. I've seen you do it.
me, God. And someone is writing in it about the things of God. In a long white tablet, black, with it, and they're writing the things of God.
See you again.
And sound mine. Father, in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, as we leave this place but not your presence, we bless your holy name. We thank you in the name of Jesus Christ for all the prayers. We thank you for covering and caring for daughter Tia. We thank you for bringing brother Herman on. We thank you for all of the people you are taking care of. We thank you for prayer and scripture. And we thank you, my Lord, for those young people who gave all they had in worship. We thank you for your presence and your very word, which means everything. We ask that you continue to maintain and grow what you have started. Bless us in such a way we know it's you. Continue to watch over the prayer requests. Even as unto them. In Jesus' name. My Lord and my King, watch over our commute now home. Give us traveling mercy to and fro. Marcus, in the name of Jesus Christ, we ask in the name of Jesus that you touch every dime, every penny, nickel, dime, quarter, dollar, $5, $10, $20, $50, whatever, to go where you have it to go. We know, my Lord, that when it looks like we don't have enough to feed the people, then all we have to do is put it in your hands. And you can take a little of this and a little of that and make it so much that people leave with seconds and thirds. You're just unusual like that. In the name of Yahshua, Jesus Christ the righteous, as this minister would say, bless all those that don't have jobs with jobs. And bless all those rich jobs to prosper on it. In the name of your Son, Jesus Christ. And let no weapon formed against us prosper. We know there are weapons being formed, but they cannot prosper. In the name of Jesus Christ. And for all the husbands and wives and children and godchildren and grandchildren that are not in this service or on social media. Lord, let the word of God reach out and grab them. Let the word of God reach out and hug them. We're not trying to send anyone to hell, but that all will come to repentance. We're not trying to see anyone get divorced, but that every situation will be reconciled in Jesus' name. My Lord, turn that thing around for your daughter. Turn it around for your son. In the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, give to who right and really is. To whose right it really is. My Lord and my King. My Lord and my King. In Jesus' name we pray. Let your heart say amen, amen. Come on, put that mask on and put your arms around one another.